let us imagine now that we are a global government and we need to increase, intensify the struggle on aging. So let us see what resources we get in terms of longevity research organizations, including academic organizations and activism organizations. So now I'm using the data of aging portfolio, which was created by Alex Zharonkov. This is a project where they used content analysis to extract data from the internet to see which organizations are funding best the research related to aging. And this data for some recent years is divided by country. And according to this database, we see overwhelming domination of the United States in terms of funding aging related aging research. And it is quite magnificent in terms of numbers. It is just eliminations by the order of numbers. And one thought which one can have looking at this, that maybe we should ignore the whole of the rest of the world, ignore Europe, and just concentrate on the United States. Let us see if this is really the case. Here is another picture from the same database and with a bit fewer years, representing how, according to aging portfolio, the funding of aging research is being distributed. And we see again the domination of the United States, with Germany coming to second. And we see that among the states of the United States, California taking the leading role, then Massachusetts, then New York, Pennsylvania, Michigan, and others. Indeed, United States decided to invest into the innovation research, and one of the important mechanisms is the National Institute of Health, of course, as you know. And other countries did not follow that to this extent. So what we see in terms of results? This is a project of one Canadian team which has been analyzing scientific performance of the countries by different academic fields. And this is the field of aging biochemistry and molecular biology. So the number of papers, citable papers, and age index, which is the index of good cited papers by country. So here we see again that the United States is taking the leading role. At the same time, European countries are also much more close, also having a serious impact. Why I choose to group the countries by age index here, it was because we had strange situation interesting with Italy, because Italy is producing a lot of papers, but they are a bit less cited than, for example, German papers. So we also have to find out what's happening. So, if we divide the number of citable papers by population size, we have a different picture. We see that Finland, Sweden, and Denmark taking the first two places, and they are quite close countries, Scandinavian countries, and they are leading in terms of per capita citable papers in aging research in terms of aging biochemistry and microbiology. And then it is followed by Israel, Switzerland, Italy, and the United States is in the first 10. So first of all, we see that the first three countries are one of the countries with the highest indicators of development. And in general, the interest to aging research correlates with development indicators. And Secondly, we see that perhaps we should not give up on Europe, that European researchers, they are more efficient in terms of papers published per capita and per dollar. And perhaps that means that the United States researchers, since they have more access to resources, they make more expensive projects, which require more equipment and so on, and this is also a very important niche. But that means that we absolutely should not give up on Europe, and we need to make sure that aging research is being developed in the European Union too. If we go beyond, what else do we see? We see actually domination of the West, then we see a little bit from Japan, South Korea, Brazil. Russia, unfortunately, is not close. Yes, I don't see it. So, yeah, for now, aging research is mostly a Western enterprise. And this is another map, a map from João Petro's database, who is who in senescence. He calculated, thank you so much, Sam. He just identified all the researchers which matter in his opinion. And yeah, we see that many of them in the United States, Europe is active, but some European countries are not that important according to this database. And there is something happening in Russia, something happening in Australia, actually something happening in India, in China, and in Japan, and in Korea. Yes, so a bit different picture, but generally, yes. So, indeed, right now it is mostly the Western researchers are developing it. But of course, we see that the other parts of the world are developing, that we see GDP growth per capita, and hopefully other continents will join our struggle of aging, and now we could try to predict how we could use the global specialization. So this is United States map of science in terms of the number of cited papers published, how it is being distinguished between various branches of research. To tell the truth, if I show you French, Germany, Italy, just any Western countries, the picture would be completely similar. So the Western science is has the most prominent number of publications in medicine, and biochemistry and genetics and molecular biology are also truly important fields. And this is good, so it shows that the Western science, global science, is being oriented towards health. And this is very good for our field, very perspective. So we see a bit of engineering here, other sciences, and so on. If we speak about China, for example, we see much that engineering is taking a lead with medical sciences, and medicine and biochemistry taking much more modest role. Which means that probably in terms of global specialization in the relevant research, Chinese researchers will probably take more technical role, and this is already happening. They say that Chinese researchers are doing quite a lot in terms of gene transcription, so maybe they would really be helping the humanity with technical stuff. And if we talk about India, we see quite pronounced role of chemistry. So medicine plays quite big role, and the biochemistry and genetics, but we see bigger role of chemistry. Regarding agricultural sciences, this is just typical for third world countries, so don't pay attention to this. But hopefully, so we shall see that we can predict that India, when it develops more, when we have more aging biology researchers there, it could be specializing on pharmacology. And besides, the regulation there is quite beneficial. Then for East Europe, you have very strange physics and astronomy taking the leading part. This is definitely the heritage from the Soviet Union, when the science was oriented to space, to physics, to nuclear weapons. And being from an East European country, I can say that we're already trying to use it, because quite a lot of people come to bioinformatics from physical scientists, from physical sciences. So we have a lot of mathematicians, physicists, guys coming to aging research, opening companies, and so on. So this would be perhaps an East Europe civilization. So after this global review, let me talk a bit about activism. In fact, I have been working in the field of tobacco control with one of most effective global non-governmental organizations. So let me share what, in my opinion, is the secrets of the success of non-governmental organization or successful activism, what you need. In most fields, you don't need as much the communication with research community as you need it in promoting biology of aging research, longevity research. And here it is absolutely necessary that longevity activists are in very good contacts with the research community. And actually we suffer from, because research community is the one which would be able to lobby it, to advocate it, so we definitely need strong researchers on board. And we have to talk to them, to engage them. So we see Aubrey did huge work over his years by engaging a lot of researchers. So we all have to work with prominent researchers trying to get them on board doing this. So we need to look credible. And because if you look too freakish, it might be quite cool for a party, but you will not be taken seriously by the society. So no tattoos on the face, nothing like that. Maybe a little bit. Yes, we need to show our analytical and writing capacity. We need to show that we are experts, even though we sometimes do not have a major in biochemistry. So we need to be sustainable financially. We need to try to find somehow salaries for at least some people. This is actually a bad, because we are all brothers in arms and we have to compete for resources, but it's necessary to have as many people paid full time as necessary as possible. Yeah?
All the mic near the mic. Yeah.
Okay, so I was talking about that we need to make sure that as many people as possible get paid and ideally full-time jobs in longevity movement, so it really increases effectiveness. We need good contacts in the government, so to be effective we need to know who exactly in our Ministry of Health or Department of Health is working, is in charge. We need to know who is in the Department of Science is in charge. We need to know a few parliamentarians, at least five, and they should be not abstract figures for activists if they want to be successful, but we need to know them to be acquainted. And it's quite easy. You just need to go to various round tables with governmental participation in parliaments. They do it sometimes. You just need to participate in this. We need working contacts with business communities, with pharmaceutical companies, with all relevant business organizations. We need to be in general good in alliance building, and to contact with patients organizations like Alzheimer patient organizations, cancer patient organizations, as much as possible. And we need good media relations. By good media relations, I mean quite specific thing. And in my opinion, the thing which works best, unless you are a TV star, you need a number of friends which are personal contacts and journalists and who are also motivated to help to find to fight aging. So we need anti-aging activist journalists, and these guys, they will be looking for opportunities to publish something. They will be fighting for these papers with their chief editors. They will be inviting you. So we need like personal relations. We need their numbers and their cell phones. And to achieve that, you have to make friends with such journalists and then invite them home, go to nightclubs, go to tourist vacations with them. They have to become your friends, and then you will be in media. Unless you are, well, maybe if you are Aubrey, you have other ways, but if you want to be in media, this is the way. And it's, even if you're a modest person, you want to push your agenda. And this is the ideal situation. What do we have at the international level? Let us see. In fact, the intergovernment, we have United Nations, which is global government, not us, but the organization which has mandates to develop global health policy is World Health Organization. Unfortunately, it is not focused yet on biology of aging. There are two relevant departments, one of the Department of Aging and Life Force, and it is producing surprisingly empty papers. They are mostly concentrated on assisting older people to live well when they are already not very good feeling, when they are disabled, and nothing on how to improve prevention. Nothing about science. And there is non-communicable disease and mental health department. It is also not doing anything and promote biology of aging research. We have been talking to the key people in the World Health Organization, including DDA, including Ilya Stammer-Kuzemson. We have been talking to people from these departments, and right now they say, oh, we are underfunded, we need some country to initiate it, or some international organization to initiate this, but generally nothing really happening, and this is what we miss yet. And it's really possible to wake up a World Health Organization. It would be very helpful, but it is a lot of work. They actually started a study of longitudinal study with aging biomarkers in five countries, Russia, China, some other, USA, of course, some other countries. So they are kind of involved in research in biology of health, but not in adults. But anyway, it's good that at least they have a study in biology of aging, so hopefully it will move them. Then what international associations do we have? I'm happy to announce the registration of International Longevity Alliance. It's a new early coming organization, but it's already has branches in a lot of countries, including Russia, American Longevity Alliance, and so on. So we decided to register this because we didn't see a truly global organization in place. So there is Longevity Forum. There is Longevity Party on Facebook, but they are like a social network. Recently, there is a new organization, International Society of Aging and Disease, but we don't really know. It is based in South California, but we don't really know who are them. So these are the only international longevity organizations which we have, I mean, globally, not regional, but global, this case. And if we speak about other organizations related to aging, there are some, but they're not doing proper advocacy work. For example, International Association of Geriatrists and Gerontologists. It is a very influential organization. If it would change its position, then it would influence World Health Organization, governance, business. But they're being too modest. They're saying, oh, we don't know if we can do something with aging. Aging is not a disease, please. Do not take us as radicals. So they're not really playing their role of advocating for health, of protecting health. They're just scientists, and scientists, they have to be careful about their statements. So this is major disappointment in general. There is International Federation of Aging, but it is more concentrated with organizations like 2K. It is a very influential organization. They have lobbyists, representatives of the United Nations. They work with the governments. They have prime ministers coming to their conference. But generally, they are more working with treatment, not treatment, with taking care of the elderly. For example, they work with pension houses for elderly people and so on. And there is International Longevity Center, Global Alliance. It is mostly UK-based organization that is talking about pensions. Sometimes it does something to promote, for example, Alzheimer research, but also not much help in terms of longevity promotion. And HelpAge International, it is also just advocacy for retired people. So this very big and strong and powerful organizations with a lot of resources and sponsors, they're not yet involved. And we have been trying to involve them into longevity movement, but it's not so easy. So let us talk a little bit about the USA as the global leader in terms of research and funding and activism. So what strengths we have? We have unique situation of government directly investing into research in biology of aging, into longevity research. They have specifically funded program. So they have strong research community and strong activist community, good investment opportunities, and we all love alliance with IT industry. And United States wants to be the global leader for innovations, which is very good for us, and general philanthropies. But the progress has been impeded with FDA taking too much protective position and taking monopoly, even though it actually has conflict of interest because it's developing governmental policy and then implements it, and it typically shouldn't be in the same organization. It's just wrong, but they do so. Another problem with the USA is that the whole decision making is happening mostly in Washington, so you have to live in Washington to be able to lobby. And we have like very strong advocates, but they're located in California. And in Washington, we only have Anthony Socca, and he has full-time job. And of course, we have Alliance for Aging Research, but it has limited resources. But it's doing something, actually. So we have restrictive legislation for lobbying organization. You cannot just lobby, you have to be registered somehow. And we have in the United States high influence of conservative part of the society. So these are minuses. So let us look at the funding. This is the budget of National Institute of Aging. So this, we see that a little bit less than 200 million go to aging biology, and plus half a billion dollars go to neuroscience, mostly to Alzheimer's disease. And this is quite good resources. Of course, it's not being sometimes used effectively. And we all know that about half of the papers produced on this money is never getting published. This is the strange thing about American science, but these are good resources. And thanks to advocacy of Alliance for Aging Research and other organizations, there is an initiative called Geroscience in the National Institute of Health. So they unite about 20 institutes, and we see 20 institutes of National Institute of Health, and we see that they're going to propose a common fund proposal. They had a very good conference, as people say, it was very good. So I couldn't open this page, maybe it was hotel internet problem, but anyway. So they're planning to apply for more money, which would be good, of course. Okay. At the same time, traditionally in the United States, private funding have been playing maybe perhaps even more role because it was a focused funding. For example, SENS research program It is directly focused on solving specific academic problems, on testing specific hypotheses, and it is much better than just peer-reviewed system when you get a lot of grants on testing something on C. elegans, calorie restriction on C. elegans. So here you have much more effective investment. Buck Institute is doing great job. Glenn Foundation, it is sponsoring the American Federation of Aging Research. So unfortunately we see that Edison Medical Foundation is going to cease its program. They do not give any new grants. Hopefully they change their mind. And of course we all hope that Google, with its promises to invest more than $1 billion, will change the situation. We shall see. So far it was really strange. Huge thing was announced, nothing was happening. The leaders of aging biology research community cannot contact this organization in many ways, so we just can hope that it will be hopeful. And of course, we should say that in the United States there are a really strong activist community which is encouraging researchers, encouraging journalists, decision makers, and it is just the biggest concentration of life extensionists, especially in California. It's very nice to visit all this. And let us talk now about European Union. So HILS is the key organization, pan-European Union organization. Now we have seen that European Union is important, so we have to all globally monitor what HILS is doing to make sure that HILS is not ignoring important issue. So let us all be busy with this. Also, it was announced that HILS is like the biggest continental organization. I think HILS always also has members from the United Kingdom, so it is truly pan-European organization. And there is also perhaps pan-European organization foundation for indefinite lifespan by Mariusz. I looked again for aging portfolio, and it says that in general, the European Commission is giving less money to biology of aging research than it used to. Checked again with Alexander Zhavrenko, so he says yes, that there is decline. So hopefully the situation will be changing, because right, this doesn't look very positive. Eduard and Miriam and our colleagues have been involved into initiating more programs, funding programs of aging research. And there is European Innovation Partnership on Active and Healthy Aging. They have been very much disappointed that the main program on aging biology was excluded from the list of the work groups because of the lobbying of Nestle and the corporation which are selling wheelchairs. Of course, this is very important, but still, it's wrong when public interest is being perhaps ignored in favor of organizations which can make money easily. So our colleagues were very disappointed with this happening, and this actually says that we need at the European Union level and general lines with, for example, pharmaceutical industry. But in the end, it was not that bad. And we see that the granting programs developed kind of on the basis of this proposal. It does include quite important points. For example, there will be 80 billion euro program for 7 years. And one of the goals is to improve understanding of the causes and mechanisms underlying healthy aging and disease. So I think that the researchers could apply for longevity research under this condition. And actually, the next deadline is quite soon. There is 330 million euro competition, and the deadline is when? October 14th. So, in fact, even though Eduard and Miriam, they were very disappointed, we see that advocacy works. There are relevant programs, and we need to encourage our scientists to apply. It will be very pity if this goes to wheelchair industry, which is very important industry, but we need to promote longevity research. If we speak of the United Kingdom, in general, the government acknowledges and its funding mechanism acknowledges that they have program on aging research. And this is very good. We can see it resulting in papers. Yeah, we have to remember that SENS is also a British organization. Then we have Jean Pedro's initiative and Institute of Gerontology. So Alexander is doing a lot of activism. So he has recently done something like PDSM conference, which was not on PDSM but on big data analysis in aging research. So they do quite a lot of interesting activism. Well, for Germany, we see the situation when there are strong institutions doing aging research, but we do not see very strong activism, at least it is not being organized enough to be visible. Maybe one problem is again that Germany is a federative state and the decision making process is kind of difficult. So, but for Germany, we don't see really much organization and activism. Interestingly, we see a lot of happening in Denmark, and we actually see it in, resulting in a lot of papers per capita. So if we talk about Japan, so in other European countries, what we see only just some institutions, not really very much happening in terms of activism. So in France, we have longevity centre. This is good. Generally, in Europe, I think we lack a good, well-organized activism on national level. In Japan, Japanese scientists are quite strong in terms of research results, but there is very little done in terms of longevity movement. We were able to identify just one PhD student interested in biology of aging to extend life. Just one very nice lady. We hope she would be leading Japanese Longevity Alliance. But she says she doesn't know anybody else interested in this. There is, of course, John Leonard somewhere in another city. But yeah, and in Korea, there is actually three gerontological associations interested in that. They were even trying to push for a bill. I will say about this later. But we do not see like quite strong research centers. So, and in Russia we have very strong activism. For some reason we have very strong immortalist transhumanist community. And to tell the truth, it has been pushing various initiatives, which have sometimes had much more than national scale. But for science, unfortunately, Russia is not that strong yet. So we're just trying to push to develop more scientific research, to start new initiatives. But now we are only good mostly in activism. But it is resulting, so we have like some companies getting grants who develop drugs against aging. We have new research labs set, so we hope that in some few years we could improve the situation with research. I think the situation is improving in Israel. There is Vadim Freifeld in Ben Gurion University with his very active position. He has a lot of PhD students and young scientists. And they're producing quite a lot of good papers, and they are very sincerely life extensionists. And then we have Ilias Tamber. He registered Israel-Longevity Alliance. And they invited Aubrey to speak, so Aubrey impressed everyone. And as a result of all this together, of this advocacy, the Ministry of Science announced $4 million grant program for Israeli researchers for longevity and quality of life. Basically, it will probably be used for longevity research. $4 million is quite good for quite small country, so advocacy works, so we should follow this experience. Yes, and some moves in some other countries, but they're quite random initiatives. For example, Kazakhstanian government announced that it's going to invest $10 million into aging research, but they didn't really have research capacity. And in the end, this research group presented yogurt to the president of Kazakhstan. He was, I don't know how he reacted, because president of Kazakhstan, he is probably truly immortalist. So he put immortalist eagle on the, I think, some symbolics, of national symbolics, and he wanted this research to be developed, but they don't have the skill. In Taiwan, they have it as one of research strategy, but it's quite a small institution. We don't even have contacts with them. So some activism in Canada, good Institute of Gerontology in Ukraine, and a few life extensionists, but they're having quite hard financial times these days. So, and there were just two legislative initiatives. One in Korea, it was failed because Ministry of Education and Ministry of Health could not agree. And one also failed effort, the bill in Israel. So this is what basically longevity movement looks like to this day. But I should say that it's quite a good amount of resources in general. This is not bad at all what we have. There are a lot of devoted researchers, there are a lot of devoted activists, there is big change in public perception, there are business being more and more interested. So if we keep on working and we do it in a more organized and coordinated way, hopefully we'll look at that soon. So thank you, let us join the discussion. Correct me if I miss something or add something. So what shall we do? How should we increase the speed of development globally?
Thank you. Any questions? We have time for discussion later. Any short question?
Okay. Thank you, Daria, for this summary of everything what's existing concerning organizations related to longevity. Maybe there is one category you didn't approach much. It's the organizations related to Alzheimer's disease, neurodegenerative disease. And in my opinion, it's probably sometimes easier to organize something with these organizations because there is a relative consensus in the public opinion to say it is really a problem related to old age, and we have to try to do something about it. And I know, and we know also that there is big money already invested for human brain research. So maybe you can say.
Yeah, I totally agree. And perhaps maybe we should plan like Kichufast to find the closest Alzheimer organization to make working contacts so that we have the number in the cell phone. This is a really good plan. We should explore if we could work with these guys.
So, at the beginning of the presentation, you showed us that quite a few countries that have the overwhelming majority of the published papers on the biology of aging. And it seemed to me that India and China were not really in the lead, far from it. Yet on the map, a few slides after that, you showed us that India and China actually had something going on. So why is that? Is it because their papers are not translated and harder to find, or?
Okay, this is the database of Zhao Petra, of researchers which he found relevant and important, and this is his quite subjective opinion, I mean, truly respected opinion, but generally in this field. Perhaps there was someone, one or two people in his field in India and one or two people in China. So we should judge perhaps by numbers. I'm totally sure that in India and China we have much faster growth rates than in the Western countries because they have to catch up. And in a decade or two, China and India will have a lot to offer. But right now, yeah, we don't.
Yeah, you can't really compare. I mean, Finland, which was top of that list, is actually completely like Africa on the map. If you go to the map. See, there you go. So Finland is not, it's just like Africa.
It's for Jean Pedro.
Right.
Yeah. We're sure that we'll be aging research in China and India. We just have to facilitate it to make it happening faster. There are researchers, they get governmental grants, they participate with the global community. Just a question if they're going to research malaria or aging.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
We need these 2 billion brains.
Last question.
So if you could go back to the slide from aging portfolio on funding. Yes. There is some interesting things. So I don't know of any Ugandan research on aging, so Kenya, which is above, for example, Finland, which produces a lot of science papers, as we saw, citable papers on aging, and I don't know anything about research going on in those countries on aging, so
yeah, go on.
I would like to give the word to, you know, Alex, who will obviously be able to give a better insight in these statistics.
Sure, it depends on how you, on where you get the data from aging portfolio. I mean, again, I told Daria that if you like to really dig deep into that and produce a research report, you need to customize it to yourself because currently it's automatically classified. And some of the diseases, so some of the projects that look at aging and HIV are in those category. So that is the most of the projects in the aging portfolio are United States, Canada, Australia, and the European Commission. We don't look at national governments also because it's primarily in their own languages, and that becomes a completely much more complex paradigm if you are to translate some of the grants. So we only work with English-speaking grants. When you automatically classify some of those grants, when there is longevity and HIV, some of those grants get classified automatically into Kenya and Uganda, because those are either European Commission or NIH projects that look at those things. And these grants are usually very substantial, because they give for a pill or a vaccine to a very large number of people, and then look at their life expectancy, right? And, they look at their longevity and the effects on aging. If you just click on natural sciences and start classifying the projects, some of the grants get misclassified. So you really need to tag to know how to use the aging portfolio in order to use it effectively.
Yeah, and anyway, there are no other source of information about funding the aging portfolio, so